to come back to a similar area. I would like, first of all, tell you some general information why this city has so many rivers and why it looks so much like Venice with all of this. Well, at least what was the idea? So maybe you remember that in all this, there was this czar whose name was Peter I. Peter I, who was very fond of green, this soil, and to make this the foundation for the future palaces and houses stronger, they drained soil and made a lot of canals. So this is one more reason why there are so many canals in St. Petersburg. Then Peter I didn't want to have any bridges in St. Petersburg. He didn't like even an idea of a single bridge, but he was very fond of Venice and its canals, and that's why the Tsar even gave a lot of money to his friend, whose name was Alexander, who was simultaneously the governor of St. Petersburg, for digging the canals. We all have just been on that Basil Island where your boat is docked. And probably you've noticed that there are a lot of very narrow streets there. So they all were supposed to be canals. So there are about 40 streets which goes one parallel to another one. They are all very narrow, and all buildings were constructed along these streets because they all were supposed to be the canals. But a friend of Peter, instead of digging canals, he spent this money on the construction of his luxurious palace. And that's why, unfortunately, the dream of Peter I never came true, and the canals, dozens of canals, were never dig on the Basil Island. But anyway, the Tsar banned the construction of all bridges in St. Petersburg, and every resident of St. Petersburg received a small boat. The boat, every resident of St. Petersburg. And it was Peter I who wrote down the rules how to operate this boat himself. So if there were several hundred dozen of people living in St. Petersburg, every person had a boat, and there were no bridges. As for the Neva River, the first bridge across the Neva River, N-E-V-A, that's how we should spell the name of this river, the first one was created only 150 years after the city was founded, in the middle of the 19th century. Before that, this was just the pontoon bridges here in St. Petersburg. Just the pontoon bridges. Sometimes, there was no limitation here. The next thing to have a boat, their private boat, or it's so cold, always. It's so cold in Russia, so half of the year the rivers were covered with ice, and people used to cross them just on ice, and they had the skating and skiing on the ice. So that's a little story about the river, the bridges, and the reason for such a big number of canals just in one St. Petersburg. So far, let me give comments about the buildings which were passing by, and it seems to me that most of you right now are attracted by the beauty of the fortress which is coming on your left-hand side. It is Peter and Paul Fortress. Peter and Paul Fortress, which was named so in honor of two apostles, Peter and Paul. So look how big, how mighty it looks like. The walls of the fortress are rather low. These are just several they are just several meters high, and that's it. In comparison to the fortresses which were constructed, let's say, in 15th century, in 16th century, and the walls were very high in order for enemies not to reach it, these walls are so low, and still, this fortress never saw an action. Nobody ever tried to capture it. That's because the fortress has such a plan of a prolongated hexagon with six bastions and two ravelins that the perimeter of the fortress is very, very big. The fortress is about 2 kilometers in perimeter, which helped to place hundreds of cannons on top of it, hundreds of cannons. And that's why in the 18th century it was much more important to have a big number of cannons on the walls to protect the fortress. Right now, the grounds of the fortress are used as the museum, but in old days, it was a military fortification with a lot of buildings which were constructed for the soldiers, which were made as houses for the artillery, and also there was the prison simultaneously here. Now there are about 20 museums on the grounds of this fortress, 20 museums. But this fortress is tremendously popular, not only because of these museums, but mostly because of the sand beach, which we all can see so well. Yesterday, when we visited the fortress, it was the usual day of the week, so you couldn't see a lot of people there. But believe me that when this is the day off, there are hundreds of people on the island of the fortress, sentating, enjoying themselves on this beach, because it's the only place where Russians can find one in the city center. Well, so lucky with the weather, at least in the morning, but it tends to be cloudy again, but don't be disappointed, because usually, according to statistics, there are only 60 days of sunny weather a year. 60 days a year here in St. Petersburg. Of the weather, which is perfectly sunny, no wonder that there is the joke about the weather popular in St. Petersburg, that there are 9 years, 9 months of expectations and 3 months of disappointment here in St. Petersburg. And that's very typical for the city. That's why every little chance local people used to get some vitamin D, that's for sure, right on the grounds of this fortress, which they also use for different championships like volleyball, some sand sculpture competition contest, and other things. So the fortress is still tremendously popular. Then on the grounds of the fortress, it's very easy to see Cathedral, which we visited yesterday, which is the tallest structure in the city center. The height of the spire of the cathedral is 122.5 meters high, 122 and a half, which must be equal to 360 feet, I would say. And this is the place where the imperial family was buried. And on top of the spire of the fort of the cathedral, there is the angel, which holds the cross, because every Orthodox church must have a cross. And I would like to share with you one of the Russian traditions. Maybe some of you are familiar. And does anybody can tell me what I mean if I do like that, if I flick under my chin? Okay, I can stand if you don't see me really well. If I flick under my chin, like that. Does anybody know? No? That's your second day in Russia. Okay, that's why you came here. It means let's have a drink. Let's have a drink. And it's a tradition which is quite widespread all over the country. Everybody knows it. Every Russian knows it. Yeah. So we should flick. Yes, under the chin. And let me share you why this tradition is so popular and why everybody knows about it. So the tradition goes to the angel, which we can find on top of the spire. Because in 1730, so in the beginning of the 18th century, there was a very strong wind in St. Petersburg, very strong wind, after which the angel was declined. And of course, they had to fix it upright. And these were the engineers of the Empress who calculated how much money they all need to make the scaffolding around such a high spire and fix an angel. And then the Empress, when she was showing the numbers, she was shocked with a very high price for the scaffoldings, and she refused to waste so much money. And then she ordered to find a very strong man who would be eager enough to climb on top of the spire without any scaffoldings and fix the angel himself. And what do you think? They found such a fool. Actually, he was alcoholic, and he had nothing to lose, and he had no family, no property, really nothing, and he agreed to do this job because he was paid. He was promised to be paid with whatever he wanted, and he agreed to do this very dangerous job. And he took a heavy ball and tied it to a rope, and then threw it into the air. And he fixed the ball on top and climbed on top of the spire just using the rope and his fingers. And that's 120 meters high, 360 feet about. And so he did the job. Then he came to the Empress and he said, well, you promised to pay me. And she offered money, palaces, she offered some noble sign, and but he refused to take anything because he asked to give him a piece of paper, which would be the Tsar law, verifying that he could get a drink free of charge in the bar. A drink free of charge, so like the Empress paper. And what? She had to do it, she had to give it to him because she promised to pay him. But of course, he's, very soon he lost it. And that's why, when he came back and said, well, I'm sorry, I lost the paper, could you give me another one? She decided to make a tattoo on his neck under the chin. So that he came and showed his tattoo under the chin, and everybody must give him this free shot. Yeah, and it's not just a fake story which I want you to, to hear. That's because there were a lot of dangerous jobs in this country, and this became a very, and a lot of alcoholics, of course, and it became a very popular drink. Very popular drink and kind of payment, I would say. So when you come to a Russian restaurant, if you want to get some beer in the restaurant today or vodka, just show it to the waiter and he will never ask you coffee or tea. What do you mean? He will offer you all of this whiskey, brandies, and so on, so on. Yeah. Well, what about the other sites which we are passing by? Now on your left hand side, let me draw your attention at this glowing little dome, which we can see on your left-hand side. This is the chapel, which was constructed in 2003, right on top of the place where the Orthodox Church of Holy Trinity was destroyed. This chapel on your left-hand side. There were thousands of churches destroyed by the Soviet government, thousands of churches all over the country. Maybe you remember this St. Isaac's Cathedral or the Church on the Spielplatz. Fortunately, they were not destroyed, though some of them were filled in with gunpowder and the decision to explode it was cancelled at the last moment. But thousands of churches were destroyed, though officially religion wasn't forbidden. Officially, it wasn't forbidden, but if the person wanted to have a nice job, to have a career, and they didn't want to have problems with KGB, he was not supposed to go to churches. But people were really afraid of KGB, believe me, that this organization scared everybody, especially in 1930s. Let me share one of the anecdotes with you to give you how bad the KGB was in comparison to right now. This is the joke which happened in the Kommunalka flat. Kommunalka flat, that's the flat which had several families living in it. So at the Soviet time, Soviet government usually gave one family just one room in the flat. And if the flat here in the city center had, let's say, five, seven rooms, there were five or seven families living there who had to share a kitchen, share a bathroom. And so that story about KGB happened in this Kommunalka flat. So just imagine, 1930s, and this was night time. And everybody heard the knock of the door. Knock, knock, knock. And they all were so scared. They were sure that this was the KGB officer who came to arrest one of them. And they all were so scared. And then they heard it again. Knock, knock, knock. And they all pretended that they were asleep. But then the oldest person who was living in that flat, he said, well, I'm the oldest. I've had such a long life. What should be I afraid of? That could be the bravest. Go outside and check what's happening. And he went outside, and he came back and said, "Comrades, comrades, don't worry. It's only fire." Well, you see, they were not so much afraid of fire as the KGB, but that's why a lot of people didn't visit the churches, and a lot of them were destroyed. Unfortunately, the ones which were not destroyed were turned into, let's say, temples of like museums of atheism, kindergartens, prison, mental hospitals, and so on. So on. Then also on your left-hand side, very soon we are going to pass by the long yellow building, which is the apartment house. The long yellow building on your left hand side. The apartment, which was constructed in the early 20th century by the order of the Soviet government, who decided to give flats in this apartment free of charge to the political prisoners. So the ones who were imprisoned by the order of Nicholas II and his mother, so political prisoners. And now it is one of the most prestigious places to live, because look, just imagine what a view they have through the windows. And it's the city center. The quality of the building is the best, because at Stalin time, everything was the best. They were so afraid of him that they did their job very well. And on top of this long yellow building on your left-hand side, there are two statues. The statue of the worker and the statue of a soldier. So these are representative of two main classes of the Soviet Union. Then let me draw your attention on your right-hand side. And now we are passing by this long chain of the buildings. I hope that with all of my stories, you don't forget to enjoy the panorama during our chance to see a city from the water. So I would like to draw your attention at these palaces. So they belong to the richest families of Russia, to the millionaires who had enough money to have their palace right in the city center. And talking about the blue one, which is on your right hand side, this is the palace which belonged to a famous Russian general, Kutuzov. This name must be familiar, because we saw the portrait of Kutuzov yesterday in the Hermitage. This was the main general of the Russian army during the Napoleonic War, which was, of course, very important for Russians. And Kutuzov was the best general, and unfortunately he was wounded during the war, and he died quite soon after the war. But the embankment, which is on your right-hand side, is named after him, Kutuzov embankment. As for the rest of the structures which are coming on your right-hand side, so look at its elegant atmosphere. So that's why I like St. Petersburg so much. I think that that's the most romantic, the most elegant and peaceful city you can find in the whole country. Well, that's the only city which you see in this country. So you just should trust me, that's the best. And that's because after the construction of the Winter Palace, it was forbidden to make anything else higher than the Winter Palace. That's why all structures of St. Petersburg, which were constructed before the Soviet time, they all are so flat. They are not higher than 22 meters high, and they have two, three, or sometimes four stories. So that's why the city looks so peaceful and so harmonious, because all the buildings are very low. Then all of them have pale colors, and like yellowish, pinkish, bluish, greenish. Peter I wanted St. Petersburg to look like Venice, and he didn't want gloomy buildings to be constructed in the city. And that's why if somebody wanted to have the facade colored in dark color, like dark gray, dark brown, they had to pay a lot of taxes. Sometimes the tax was equal to about the cost of the whole palace. So that's why the majority of palaces in St. Petersburg are very pale. And then on your right hand side there is the view to the Neva River. Well, the river is rather short. That's the direction to the middle of the country, to Lake Ladoga. And that's also the area where St. Petersburg will be over soon. Then on your right-hand side also there is this low yellow building. Do you see it so far? Yeah? Coming on your right, but straight ahead over there. The low yellow building, which was one of the first stone buildings constructed in St. Petersburg. This is the building of the military hospital, which was constructed at the time of Peter I. By the way, the Tsar learned medicine himself as well, but unfortunately all his patients died, so he was a good Tsar but not a very good doctor. Unfortunately, he gave up. And, and gave a chance to professionals to take care of the soldiers. So that was the military hospital, one of the first stone buildings of St. Petersburg, and it's still hospital. And I remember I was walking next to the facade of this yellow building, and a hospital for soldiers, and it's of course forbidden to smoke inside. Once I remember there was the box tied to a rope hanging from the second floor with the words, "Oh, please put a cigarette into it," like that. But cigarettes are not expensive, unfortunately. It's, one pack costs just a couple of dollars. So smoking is a big problem, but the government tries to fight with it, and probably, little by little, the situation will change soon. Then, on your left-hand side, in the distance, we are coming closer and closer and closer to a big gray boat, which is called Cruiser Aurora. So this three-chimney gray boat, we're coming closer, so you definitely all will be able to see it. This is the boat which was launched in 1903 for the Russian-Japanese War. Unfortunately, Russians, of course, lost that war. Next time, this boat was used in the First World War. She was too old for the Second World War, which happened in the middle of the 20th century, but its cannons were taken off the boat and were placed along the front line for the protection of the city. But right now, this boat is in the Bolshevik Revolution of 1917. So there were a few revolutions in the early 20th century in this country. The February Revolution, which triggered the abdication of Nicholas II. Then the provisional government was in charge of the country for half a year, and then these were the Bolsheviks who decided to arrest the provisional government. A lot of people sided with Lenin. Mostly these were... soldiers and workers and poor people who sided with Lenin, and a lot of sailors on this boat sided with Lenin. So they decided to organize the revolution, the coup d'etat, and the sailors on this boat gave the blank shot from this boat, from the cannon which is at the prow right here. And it was the signal for the troops to start the assault of the Winter Palace. And this was soldiers and sailors who rushed into the Winter Palace, which we visited yesterday. Maybe you even remember the area of Rembrandt, that staircase which most of us used to go downstairs. So it was that staircase which they used in order to rush into the Winter Palace, and they arrested the provisional government and proclaimed Soviet Union, which stayed, which existed for about 70 years. And the Bolsheviks liked this boat very much, and they made this the museum. It is the museum simultaneously. These are the cadets of the cadet school, which use it sometimes just to see how it used to work in the 20th century. It never moves, but there is this blue and gray building, which now is coming on your right. And this is the gray and blue building on the cadet school, named after Nahimov. Well, as for the area where we are right now, so right now we are in the former part of St. Petersburg, which was built up with houses in the early 18th century, I would say. That's why buildings here are not that pretty, are not that fancy. They're rather so simple, especially on your right-hand side. There are some modern structures on your left-hand side. As for the modern buildings, on your left, the glass glossy building with a spire. This is the apartment house, the apartment with the spire. Then this ugly building with these blue letters. This is the hotel. It's called St. Petersburg, and it's a very typical kind of architecture for St. Petersburg, I would say, because that's the Soviet type. So they didn't really care how the building looks like from outside. That's Soviet type of construction, I would say, not really at all. So now we're passing by this boat. So close, there is a chance to enjoy. And that's exactly how the boat was made 100 years ago. In 1903 it was launched. Yeah, and there are some sailors right here. This is quite a popular museum. Sometimes it is open for display for people. Sometimes there are these Russian oligarchs who even rent this museum boat for their big parties. Maybe you have heard about such a guy as Prokhorov, maybe not. But he had a big party right here not so long time ago. He's a dollar millionaire, the one who stole so much money from Russian taxes. My taxes. My oil. But he must be a very clever man, as he's still not in the jail. Well, right now, my dear guest, we are coming back to the main part of the Neva River. Why I say main part? Because Neva River is rather short in comparison to other rivers of St. Petersburg, but full of water. And it has several weeks, I would say. Now we're coming back to the main one, and now there is a chance to enjoy this gorgeous panorama of St. Petersburg. Let's keep our fingers crossed that the sun is still shining, and we can enjoy the views. On your right-hand side, in the distance, there is this Holy Trinity Bridge. We have been already under this bridge, now we are going in this direction again. The Holy Trinity Bridge. This is one of the raw bridges across the river. All in all, across the Neva River, there are 22 bridges. 21 of them are draw bridges. 21 of them. And of course, the central part of the bridge is either raised or they open the central part, because the navigation period lasts for about half a year. Since early April, late April, up to early November. For half a year, there are hundreds of boats which are waiting in the Gulf of Finland at night, their turn to move through St. Petersburg when the bridges are opened. And of course, it's a very big problem, I must share with you, in St. Petersburg with bridges, because when it's 1 o'clock in the morning, since once up to 5 o'clock, all bridges are opened, except for one. And of course, it's a big problem to get from one side of St. Petersburg to another one. But fortunately, several years ago, one more bridge was constructed so high that they don't need to open it. Well, before that, there was quite a big problem which wives had with their husbands, who called somewhere in the middle of the night and said, "Honey, I wanted to come back home from a party with my friends, but you know, all the bridges are open, so I will be back in the morning. Just don't worry, I'm fine. Somebody will entertain me. Don't worry, I will not miss you too much." No more excuses like that. There is a high bridge, thanks to which people can get from one side of St. Petersburg to another one. And there are 21 road bridges across St. Petersburg, because they all are opened at night, since 1 up to 5 o'clock, I would say, sometimes 6. So, and that's talking about Neva. Of course, there are a lot of other bridges across the canals and rivers which we are passing by. So, right now, let me continue mentioning some of the buildings. Like, for example, this pinkish building with the green roof on your right-hand side, with the flag on top of it, is used by the representative of the Russian president in St. Petersburg. Nobody knows what this person does, but at least that's the building which he uses. Then on your right now, let me draw your attention at this ugly gray building with green letters. So this is the apartment house, which was given to people free of charge, of course, at the Soviet time. But this is the building which doesn't have any kitchens. Can you imagine?
No kitchen.
Yeah, ladies. Just imagine, Soviet government wanted to get rid of the kitchen slavery. Sounds good. That's why in this apartment, as well as in many other ones all over the country, there are no kitchens.
And according to the Soviet idea, everybody must go to the communal canteens on the first floor of the apartment for the communal breakfast, like in hotels. Then they all received a lunch to go, and they were served dinner in the evening for the inhabitants of the apartment. So quite a good idea, please. It never worked, but good idea. Then on your right-hand side, the yellow and black boat. This is the boat which, the modern one, imitation of the boat of Peter the First time. It's a restaurant. And in the behind the painting, behind of this park, there are the minarets of mosque. And there are many temples of religions of different confessions here in St. Petersburg. Then on your right-hand side, I would like to draw your attention at this view to this summer garden. Have a look at this garden on your left-hand side. We were passing by several times. Now there is a good chance to enjoy this beauty of the railing, of the fence of the summer garden. I know two stories which are connected with the fence of the summer garden, which is on your left-hand side over there. The fence is very elegant, hope you have noticed. And one story sounds like a legend, really like a legend. And one of them says that there was an Englishman who traveled all over the world and was looking for the very best views. And it happened so that he dropped his anchor next to the railing of the summer garden, and he was so stunned with the beauty of this railing that he enjoyed it for a few hours, and then told the captain to come back home because finally he found this very most beautiful thing in the world. I know, sounds like a legend. But there is another true story. There was this, the American government, which offered 100 locomotives in for this fence to the Soviet government. Of course, the Soviets needed these locomotives very much, but the Minister of Education refused to change the locomotives for this fence, and fortunately, Russians still have it. Then have a look on your left-hand side. Now we can see this brownish building. This brownish building. This is one of the marble palaces of St. Petersburg. Marble palace. Two upper floors of this palace are decorated with a pinkish marble, a pink marble. And probably you remember this story, maybe not. Let me remind you that the palace was constructed by order of Catherine II for her lover. For her lover. Why that lover was so important for her? That's because Catherine II, she was the German princess. This was a woman who married Russian prince Peter the Third, Peter number three. Yeah, he was grandson of Peter the First. So she married him. She was invited to Russia. She married him, and maybe she was loyal to him for a year or so. But then they both had lovers. They didn't like each other at all. And of course, Catherine's lovers didn't like Peter the Third. And after palace coup, they forced Peter the Third to sign the act of abdication. He signed this paper, and he was arrested by lovers of Catherine the First or the Second. And they brought him to the prison. And on the way to the prison, when the lovers, the officers of Catherine, they had a drinking bout, some party, they accidentally killed her husband. And of course, they were upset, or pretended to be upset, and they wrote a letter to Catherine II, "Oh dear mistress, we killed your husband, sorry." And Catherine II said, "Well, what's done is done." And the official reason for the death of Peter III was that he died of hemorrhoids. That's what everybody was told. Of course, people don't die of hemorrhoids, you know. It was some kind of a thank you from Catherine II to her lover, like for getting rid of her husband. And then on your left-hand side, we can enjoy the panorama of these palaces, which also belong to the millionaires. That's because the richest people could afford to live so close to the imperial family. And these are several buildings of the Hermitage in a row, one next to another one. So the greenish one right in front of us, this is the Hermitage Theatre. Next to it, the old Hermitage, then the small Hermitage, and the brightest green and white palace. This is the Winter Palace. The palace which has 1,050 rooms. So such a huge one. And still, Empress Catherine II, who founded the Hermitage, believed that it wasn't enough for her and for her collection. That's why the rest of the buildings are suspended. Then on your right-hand side, let me draw your attention at this brown boat, which is called the Fine Dutch. It's the one which is used as a restaurant, quite a fancy boat. They say this is the most expensive restaurant of St. Petersburg. And in ships, we've seen like models of four parts of the ships, which were trophies and captured and destroyed by the Russian Navy during the war over Sweden. So for the captains of all of these boats not to have a desire to attack Russia anymore. The gray building is the former stock exchange, while the yellow building, this is the former warehouse, which is now is a zoological museum. Well, we're coming back to that area where we started the tour. We are going to move a little bit further along the river, and then we will be back here in a little time. On your right-hand side, I would like to draw your attention at this greenish and white structure, which is called the Chamber of Curiosities. Chamber of Curiosities, and it was the very first museum of St. Petersburg. And which was founded, of course, by Peter the First, who had some collection of rarities here. And he wanted local people, those who lived in St. Petersburg, to visit the museum, to culturalize them. But local people didn't want to go to the museum when they had their free time. They wanted to spend their free time with their families. That's why Peter said, okay, every lady visitor would be given a free cup of coffee, while every man a free shot of vodka. Since that time, the museum became very popular. And nobody gives us anything anymore, but it's still very popular. Then on your right, yellow and white building, this is the Academy of Science. And then coming on your right, red and white, this is the former building for the government of Peter the First. So it's early 18th century building. By the way, do you see the building for the government faces the street, not the embankment, but the street? That's because there was supposed to be the canal here, right on this island, like in Venice. But it was never did because money was spent in a different way. So the building has 12 roofs because there were 12 ministers in the government of Peter. And they were always quarreling. They were always quarreling, and that's why each of them had his own part of the building. Hence, there are 12 roofs. Now it's the main office of the main University of St. Petersburg. Then, this grayish building on your right-hand side with the red roof, partly in scaffolding, this is the cadet school, this one, as well as the next one. So this yellow one, another cadet school. And then coming on your right-hand side, yellow building with the gray roof used to belong to a very good friend of Peter the First. His name was Alexander Menshikov. Maybe you remember my story with this money for the canals I mentioned in the beginning. So Menshikov was supposed to dig about 40 canals on the island on your right, but instead he made this luxurious palace, yellow with the black roof, and the canals were never constructed. Of course, Peter was very angry with him. But they were friends. Well, maybe he come down. And then this sand-covered building in a distance on your right-hand side with the gray roof, this is the Academy of Fine Arts. The sand-covered building on your right-hand side, Academy of Fine Arts, which was constructed in the middle of the 18th century, and now it is the most prestigious place where the artist can study art. Then in the distance on your right, that's the area where the cargo port is and where your port is. Then we are going to see on your right-hand side an embankment. And this is the so-called English embankment, which was tremendously popular among Englishmen. They just like to live in these palaces on this embankment. And then coming on your right, there is this impressive view to St. Isaac's Cathedral. Before I tell you the cathedral, let me draw your attention at this yellow building, huge yellow structure at the corner, very close to us. This is the building which was made in the 19th century for the government of Peter the First. And for the top office of the church. So this long yellow building. then in front of St. Isaac's Cathedral, if you look attentively, very close to the embankment, there will be the statue to Peter the First. To Peter the First. Not in front of the cathedral, closer to the embankment. So the man on the horse, this is the so-called bronze horseman, one of the symbols of St. Petersburg, the statue of Peter the First, and the pediment is shaped like a wave to show the struggle of Peter the First to open the window to high seas for Russia. But talking about St. Isaac's Cathedral, we all visited it yesterday. Let me remind you a few numbers that the cathedral has some dozen kinds of marble which cover and decorate it from inside and from the outside. That's the reason why sometimes this cathedral is nicknamed the Museum of Mineralogy. Well, of course it's not. And let me draw your attention at this lovely dome of St. Isaac's Cathedral. It glows with gold, so shiny. And this gold was gilded in the middle of the 19th century, and it was never regilded again. Never regilded. That's because they used a special system of gilding. I have an illusion that some of you are Americans. So let me ask you a question. Have you heard that once Alaska belonged to Russia? Yeah. So that's, well, it's not really the question, but does anybody know how much America paid for it?
1 cent.
Not 1 cent, no. Well, actually, this was $7.2 million, but America paid in gold. 100 kilos of gold, and here they are, right behind of this tree. Yeah, well, this gold on the dome of St. Isaac's Cathedral is probably exactly that gold which Russia received for Alaska. Exactly 100 kilos, and it's still same gold. They never regilded again because they used a special system of gilding. When they covered this copper sheet with the substance which was called amalgam, the mixture of mercury and gold, and then they slowly heated these copper sheets. And after heating, gold. Well, mercury evaporated and gold inserted into copper. So this process was repeated 3 times, and after which a very dense layer of gold covers the dome. And now we are moving along the buildings of the Admiralty. Admiralty, this is the former shipyard, the first actually. And so it's constructed in the shape of a horseshoe. That's why there are several structures right between two wings of it, two yellow wings. And in the center of the Admiralty, there is this spire, which has a boat, which is a symbol of St. Petersburg. Well, my dear guests, I have an illusion that this first part